Welcome to chapel.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, online campus. It is Thursday, so you already know, as Valor students, we love Thursdays, and we hope you all love them too, because it's Chapel Day. My name is Leanne Nolasco. I am a junior here at Valor Christian College, the School of Revival, in the Evangelism Program here from Toronto, Canada.
And my name is Bryson Kirby. I am a freshman here at Valor Christian College, the
School
of the Spirit.
Yes.
I am from Gastonia, North Carolina.
Yes. And we hope you all had an amazing Holy Week and an amazing Good Friday and Resurrection Sunday. And hey, listen, what that week is all about is truly the gospel of Jesus Christ, about how he rose from the dead and how he is seated in victory for us and for you. And that gospel does not just stay in the four walls of the church. We took it out onto the streets all last week. We hit the streets of Columbus with City Harvest Network overseer and evangelist Miss Deborah George, and we were so blessed to be able to share the gospel with the community, to love on everybody, to see blind eyes open, to see miracles happen, to see people get healed. And we were even able to bring people to church on a van.
Absolutely.
during Sunday service Sunday morning.
Absolutely. And yes. Leanne, guess what? We saw over 600 people give their life to Christ.
Absolutely.
600 people who have now entered the kingdom of God.
Wow.
And we didn't just leave it there. Just like Leanne said, we brought them to church on Sunday morning to hear the gospel be preached. And this is just one of so many other things that the Valor students get to be a part of here at the School of the Spirit. And you can also be a part of what God is doing in the lives of our students here at Valor College by joining us for the fall semester.
Yes.
Listen, on campus, online, or through our cohorts. Just a quick shout out to all of our City Harvest Network pastors and all of our cohorts.
Yes.
Me personally, our church back home at Destiny Church International, we have a cohort, and we have seen so many people's lives be changed. The anointing that's here is not just on campus, but it's also through the cohorts and our online semesters.
Absolutely.
You don't want to miss it, and you don't want to delay what God is doing. Register today at valorcollege.edu.
Yes.
You don't want to miss it.
Absolutely.
And listen, all scholarship and federal financial aid are available to the qualifying students as well.
Right. And like Bryson said, the power of God that is in this room is tangible, and it is meeting you right where you are, wherever you are, all around this world. And we know that the miracles of God can touch your life as well, as we have an amazing preacher of the gospel here today, this morning. He is an evangelist, and he has ministered with his wife, Jessica, for the last 9 years, pastoring in Indonesia.
Wow.
He is no other than City Harvest Network overseer Jason Avanzini. So get ready, get stirred, because chapel is starting in 90 seconds.
Our best hallelujah. We're going to give him our best for a few moments. Stay right there, man. shout of victory. Release a shout of praise. Release a shout of thanksgiving to our God. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Worthy to be praised. Worthy to be praised. Worthy to be praised. Worthy to be praised. Come on, lift it up, Valor. Lift it up, Valor. Lift up your praise unto our God. Deep is calling unto thee this morning. And out of a whole shout. Glory to your name. Glory to that wonderful name. Glory to that matchless name. Our risen King, glory to your name. Oh, we love you, Jesus. Oh, we love you, Jesus. Oh, won't you inhabit the praises of your people? Inhabit our praises. Inhabit our praises. Inhabit our praises, oh Lord. Oh, your glory is our reward. Your glory is my reward. Your glory is my reward. Your presence is my reward. I don't need anything but your presence. I don't need anything but your presence. Oh, come on, is there anybody in the room that's hungry for God? Come on, cry out, Valor. Cry out, Valor. Oh, Lord, have your way. Have your way today, Jesus. Speak to us in an unusual way, God. Oh, Lord, use us this day. Use us to bring glory to your name. Use us to lift you up. Use us to magnify you. Use us to glorify you. Oh God, we are your people and the sheep of your pasture. Use us, use us, use us. Use us. Come on, Valor. I need y'all to step in this morning. I thank you, Father, that your word declares that no flesh would glory in your presence. That you and you alone would get the glory today. That you and you alone would be exalted. That you and you alone would be magnified. That you and you alone would be glorified. Oh, Lord, help us to see you. 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 Remove the scale from our eyes. Help us to see you. Remove the distractions out of the way. And help us to see you. Help us to be focused. I feel God in here. I feel like God just interrupted the agenda and stepped into place. Come on, come on, I need y'all to help me pray this morning. Yes, Lord. 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 He just interrupted us. He just interrupted us. He just interrupted us. And he's prophetic. Just like how he interrupted us. He's interrupted something in your life. I thank you, Lord God, that we are tuned into the Spirit of God. That we are sensitive to the moving of the wind of the Spirit. And God, wherever you would say, that's where we would go. Wherever the wind of the Spirit would blow, that's where we would go. Whatever you want to do in this place today, whatever you want to shake up in this room, shake everything that can be shaken so that which cannot be shaken will remain. Come on, Valor. Come on, somebody pray. Come on, somebody pray. I feel like God's doing something this morning. Come on, repentant people. Come on, repentant people. Tamron said last week that revival rides on the wings of prayer. Run the mind of a whole shake it. I need faith in the room. I need faith in the room. I need faith in the room. Watching online, God has interrupted something, and he's about to interrupt whatever the enemy had planned for your life. I feel an interruption in the realm of the spirit. I feel an accident being interrupted in the name of Jesus. I feel a death being interrupted in the name of Jesus. I feel a bankruptcy being disrupted in the name of Jesus. I feel something in this room. Father, thank you. He got a motion. He got a rabahasha. Help me to follow the wind of the Holy Ghost. Help me to follow the wind of the Holy Ghost. Help me to follow the wind of the. Help me to follow the wind. Help me to follow the wind. Blow in my sail today, God. Blow in my sail today. I said, blow in my sail today. Holy Ghost, blow. Holy Ghost, blow. Holy Ghost, blow. Blow, Spirit. Blow, Spirit of the living God. Spirit of the living God, blow. We are the school of the Spirit. We are the school of revival. And we know how to follow the leading of the Spirit of God in this room. Come on, Rabahosha. Come on, Rabahosha. Come on, Dallas. Come on, just begin to walk around and step into that. Interruption is happening. Interruption is happening now. I decree and declare it. Just like when Jesus was walking and he interrupted funerals and he brought the dead back to life. Just like things that were supposed to stay dead in your life. I feel an interruption this morning. In the name of Jesus, God is stepping into your situation. He's looking now from his holy habitation and he's interrupting every plan of the enemy. And he's bringing divine assistance in the name of Jesus. Come on, Valor. I feel divine interruption in this room. Divine interruption. Yes, Lord. Come on, somebody pray. Come on, somebody pray. Come on, somebody step into that. I feel it in the room. I said, I feel it in the room. I feel it in the room. I feel it in the room, Dad. Come on. The Bible says that we know the things that the Spirit gives to us because we have the Spirit. We know those things which he are doing. So this may have been a surprise in the natural, but it's not a surprise in the spirit. It's not a surprise to God in the spirit. Yeah, Lord. Yeah, Lord, give us back territory. Give us back territory. Give us back new ground. Give us back. Oh, yes, Lord. Give it back to us. In the host. Yes, Lord. Wherever we lost ground, give it back to us. Give it out of a host. Wherever we lost ground, give it back to us. Wherever we lost ground in our prayer life, give it back to us. Wherever we lost ground in our worship, give it back to us. Wherever we lost ground in our giving, give it back to us. Oh, yes, Lord. Oh, yes, Lord. Oh, yes, Lord. Come on. Come out of a host. Get out of a higher. You're taking your ground back. You're taking ground. Get out of a whole shop. You're taking territory again. Wherever you lost it, wherever your axe head fell, come on, pick up your axe head. Come on, go and find your axe head. Come on, get your axe head back. Yeah, oh, he comes out of a whole shop. Come on, get out of a whole shop. Come on, get out of a whole shop. Come on, somebody get militant. Get militant in this room. Hibasha, let me put up a higher. Come on, get militant in this room. Yes, Lord, wherever my axe head fell, wherever my axe head would have fallen, wherever I gave the enemy territory, give it back to me in Jesus' name. Let out of my spirit today, flow rivers of living waters. Let out of my spirit today, flow rivers of living waters. Give me my axe head back. Give me my anointing back. Let out of a whole shire. Let me pick up a militant spirit again. Let me have fresh zeal again. Let me have fresh passion again. In the name of Jesus. Oh, yeah, Lord. Come on, pray. Come on, pray, Valor. Come on, another Hoshaya. Divine interruptions are happening now. In the name of Jesus, release your faith. Release your faith. Release your faith. Release your faith. Yeah, God. Yeah, God, I pray, God, that you would interrupt the atmosphere of satanic altars. I pray, God, that you would bring down satanic altars against this nation in the name of Jesus. And negative words that were spoken over the United States of America, we decree and declare that the glory of the Lord is rising across this nation and around the world from this place in the name of Jesus. For the Bible says in Isaiah chapter 60, that when darkness covers the earth and gross darkness the people, that the glory of the Lord will arise. So Father, we decree and declare that the glory of the Lord is arising, and the glory of the Lord is covering the earth as the waters cover the sea in the name of Jesus. I feel a divine interruption in this place. Divine interruption to your health. That cancer was supposed to hit you, but I hear God say today that it's going to skip over. Yeah. Yeah. You were supposed to get high blood pressure, but I hear God say divine interruption. You were supposed to go down in a plane crash, but I hear God say divine interruption. You were supposed to go bankrupt, but I hear the Lord say divine interruption. I wish somebody would help me pray. I feel like somebody's soul is in the balance. You were supposed to lose your relationship with God, but I hear him say divine interruption. Divine interruption, Josh. That's for you. It's hope. Another Mahosha. Divine interruption, Josh Stewart. In the mighty name of Jesus, everything that the enemy meant for evil, God's turning it around. 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 Somebody just turn around. Make a prophetic declaration. Turn it around. Turn it around. Turn it around. Around in my favor. Watching online. Divine interruption is coming to your house. Oh Lord. Yeah, Lord. Yeah, Lord. Yeah, Lord. Yeah, Lord. I hear just like Elijah went to the window. He's about to interrupt your life. He's about to provide for you. And he's about to do it right out of your own house. And you didn't even know you had it. But it was right in there. And God said he's going to take what you got and provide for you. I said he's going to take what's in your hand. And he's going to make a way, Terry. He's going to make a way out of nowhere. Divine interruption. He's going to take that Red Sea and split that thing down the middle. And you're going to walk across on dry ground. And you're going to look back and the enemies that you saw, you will see no more. The enemies that you saw, you will see no more. I feel prophetic in here, Bishop. I said I feel prophetic in this room. The enemies you see today, you will see no more forever. That's the word of the Lord. That's the word of the Lord. In the name of Jesus, and touch and agree, woman of God. I feel prophetic in here today. I wish somebody would pray. God just turned something around in your favor. If you really believed it, you would be rolling all over this floor. But I said, I felt him just turn something around for somebody in this room. Somebody was, I hear you, Lord. Somebody was supposed to get a call of death in your family. But I just heard the Lord say, I just turned it around. Somebody was supposed to get a call of some bad news from back home. But I felt I just heard the Lord say, it just turned. I'm about to run all over this church. Father, I thank you for the divine interruption. Father, I thank you that you're sending angels now to encamp round about our families and to protect them wherever they are. Oh God, that you would keep them lest they dash their foot against the stone. And I thank you, Lord God, that those that don't know you as Lord and Savior in our families, that you would put a hook in their jaw and you would draw them to the altar. 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 Where's Robert? Come here, Robert. Come here, Robert. Give me your microphone. Come on, pray. Come on, pray. Come on, pray. Come on, pray. Come on, pray, Bala. Come on, pray, Bala. Step into the spirit and see what the Lord is doing. You got to see it with your own eyes. You got to see it with your own eyes. Just pray. Just pray. Just pray. Just pray.
Hallelujah. Pray in the Holy Ghost. It's not by might, nor by power, but it's by the Holy Ghost. I don't know the words to say, but sometimes all you got is a groan.
Holy Ghost.
Come on, pray in the Holy Ghost. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Come on. Come on, the Holy Ghost is locating your miracle. Pray, Batanzo. Push it out in the Holy Ghost. Thank you. Thank you. It was supposed to end in death. It was supposed to end in death. It was supposed to end in destruction. Oh, good God. I was supposed to be defeated.
That's right. That's right.
But I hear that, Ronald.
Yes.
Divine reversal.
Divine.
Watch it. Divine reversal. In the Holy Ghost. I undeadable soul. It was supposed to end in defeat.
Yes, yes.
But divine reversal.
Divine reversal.
Not by might.
Not by might.
Nor by power.
Not by power.
But by the Holy Ghost.
By the Holy Ghost. Oh! By the Holy Ghost. By might, nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. But by my spirit, saith the Lord. God is at work in your house right now, right now, right now, right now. We look into that camera.
Hallelujah.
And we declare that by the Spirit of God, things are turning. By the Spirit of the Lord, things are turning in your favor. And God is surrounding the righteous with favor as with a shield. Whatever you've been believing for, Aislinn, in your house, for your brotherhood and your families, I feel God turning it around. Turning, 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 turning it around. Yeah.
And where it looked impossible, where the door looked closed and as if it would never open again, I feel the presence of God saying that this is the year of the open door. So what that means is that that's not just a logos word, but it's a word thing. So right now you may be looking at a closed door and it doesn't look like it'll ever open again.
Yes.
Help me, Holy Ghost.
Yes.
You're looking at a closed door.
Yes.
And it looks like that door will never open.
Yes.
But hear me by the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Divine reversal.
Divine reversal.
Supernatural.
Open doors.
Supernatural.
Supernatural.
Ways made. Do you not perceive it?
Yes.
Are you not aware?
Yes.
For I'm making rivers in the desert.
In the desert.
I'm making ways in the wilderness.
In the wilderness.
Oh God, man may have closed the door, but God about to open it in their face. He prepared a table before you in the presence of your enemies. Say thank you.
Thank you. Now come on, let's praise God in it now. Oh, say thank you. Thank you. Dance, honor. Thank you for all you've done, for what you're doing. Thank you. Thank you. Say thank you, Lord. Lord, I thank you. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Your word is true. Your word is true. Your word is true. Your word is true. You won't die. This is not the end. You won't die. This is not the end. God's not From glory to glory in the name of Jesus. Come on, let's continue to worship. You've been a mighty, 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 mighty good God. Come on, let's go back to that. He's been good. He's been good. He's been great. He's been mighty. He's been strong. Come on, start the click track. Let's go back into the praise. You've been a mighty good God. Come on, keep on praising.
I know that we have a schedule to get to. But can we just lay aside the things that we have to do today? Can we just lift up the name of Jesus? Can we just exalt the King of Kings? Can we just exalt the King of Glory? The one who took on the crown of thrones. Come on, lift up your voice and come into agreement with me. Jesus, we lift you up. We lift up the Son of God, the Son of Man, the Son who was crucified, the Son who took on the crown of thorns. And we lift you up right now. And right now, as a student body, for those online and those in the room, we lift up the First Family right now in the name of Jesus. We lift up our pastor. We lift up Miss Joni. We lift up Miss Ashton and Mr. Austin in the name of Jesus. And we thank you that they are covered by the blood and that nothing could ever come across the bloodline. In the name of Jesus, we declare and we decree that no weapon formed against them shall ever prosper in the name of Jesus. And every tongue that rises up against them, they shall condemn in judgment. But this is the heritage of the servants of the Lord. In the name of Jesus, we declare that they will not fear the terror of the day, nor the arrow that flies by night. In the mighty name of Jesus, we declare and we decree that the First Family is covered on the shadow of the Almighty. In the name of Jesus, and we just thank you, Lord, that it is so and it is done. In Jesus' name,
it is so and it is done. In Jesus' name, clap those hands. Father, we thank you for it now. Thank you for releasing strength in Jesus' name. You will grant unto us out of the rich treasures of your glory to be strengthened with might and to be strengthened with power in the inner man. Lord, you said in your word, don't be weary in well-doing, for you shall reap if you faint not. And God is not unfaithful to forget our labor of love in ministering to the saints as we still do minister in Jesus' name. So we thank you, Lord God, that from the top of this place, from our first family right on down to every person that works in this ministry, every person that volunteers in this ministry, that there would be fresh strength and fresh vigor and vitality. Let a fresh wind blow across this ministry in Jesus' name. And we thank you, God, that they will see the reward of their labor in Jesus' name. The end is not yet. The name of Jesus, and I thank you, Lord, that you would continue to do great, 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 great exploits right from this place all around the world. Now somebody praise him like you know it's done. Praise him like you know it's done. Come on, give him glory in the room. Father, we thank you that it's done in Jesus' name. It's done, it's done, it's done. And we praise you. And we worship you for it in the mighty name of Jesus. Come on, clap your hands and give him glory. Hallelujah.
Come on, Valor, lift up your voice in this chapel. Come on, lift up your voice. Release a mighty roar this morning. You know, Moses, he saw the burning bush was on fire. And then in just a few moments, the fire began to speak. And can I take just a moment to celebrate that the fire of God is tabernacling right here at Valor Christian College. This is a place where revival is not a scheduled event. It is the atmosphere of the world changers. And can I take a moment and get you to praise God with me that this morning the fire of God is speaking from this place all over the world. I hear the voice of the Lord saying, behold, the Lord is with you. He's bringing you through every trial and every struggle. If I was you, I'd praise him. I'd shout, I'd spin, I'd dance, I'd glorify the Lord that the fire of God is speaking at Valor Christian College this morning. Woo! Glory to God. You can praise him back to your seat and remain standing in the atmosphere. We have a powerful preacher that is with us today. You heard him last night on our midweek service at World Harvest Church preach a message of faith. He is a son of legacy. And our pastor teaches that the anointing of God is tangible and it is transferable. And every cohort student and every cohort pastor watching from around the country this morning, get ready, because there is an anointing that is about to be released in this atmosphere. There is a release coming to some kingdom advancers and some world changers this morning. Glory to God. He is a City Harvest Network overseer. His family is precious to our pastor and the first family. Would you please welcome City Harvest Network overseer, Pastor Jason Avanzini.
Hallelujah. Can we give the Lord another shout of praise? This is an amazing atmosphere. The Lord is in this place. Come on, are you still here? Just because the band stopped, the atmosphere is still here. The Holy Spirit hadn't left. Let's give the Lord a shout of praise. Give the Lord a shout of praise. Hey! Hallelujah, hallelujah. The power of our prayer cannot be underestimated. You know, the Word of God says that we should not be conformed to the pattern of the world, but we got to be renewed by that transformation that happens in our mind. We are not going to be shaped like the world. The world is going to be shaped like us. We are not going to be forced to live in a world that has wickedness, deceit, and deception. They will have to live in our world, a world of light, of love, of mercy, of grace, of healing, of prosperity. Are you still here? My goodness. Woo! I'm excited. I am excited. And I might be the only one. Would you turn and tell the person next to you, say, the Holy Spirit looks good on you. And then you may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 All right, we're changing gears. Are you ready? Are you ready to run? All right, I want to talk to us about seed time and harvest. And a hush fell across the crowd. No, here you are. Yeah, I want to talk to us about seed time and harvest, but we're not going to have an offering at the end of this. So you can relax. I travel around a lot, different places in the world, different places in America, and one of the common things that we see that is a real blind spot for pastors is the area of finances. A lot of pastors and ministers are maybe afraid to talk about finance because they don't know exactly how to approach it. And if you don't get a hold of your finances, a financial problem will get a hold of you. So what I want to do today is show you through Scripture a few things. I want to show you some connections between our heart and our finances, okay? I want to show you a few connections between the cross and miracles. And then I want to show you a connection between miracles and the offering, because all of these things go together. Now, when God looks at you, he sees you as a completed picture. He doesn't see you as a section over here and a section over here. And this is my daily devotional time. This is my quiet time with God. And my money's over here. It's something separate. No, God looks at the whole package. He looks at all of it. And he wants you to be comfortable. He wants you to be comfortable in understanding that he wants you to prosper. And because this message of having more than enough has been abused by so many, it's become almost a caricature, right? It's become a meme of the pastor crying, saying, send $1,000 and you'll have $10,000 in 2 hours, right? We've seen this kind of thing so much that many of us have become almost deaf to this teaching about seed time and harvest. So what I want to do today, I have the message, it's called Hidden Harvests. I want to show you that there are miracles that happen all through the Bible, and it's really seed time and harvest that ignited those miracles, okay? So some of this you have heard before, some of it might be new to you, but I want to go fast and quick so you can take notes. Are you okay? Are you all right? Now let's just paint a picture here. Anytime your pastor is up talking to you, or he's preaching the gospel, we all have a mindset that we get into. Now, if he's preaching about salvation, do we think he's trying to get something from us or to us? He's trying to get something to us. If he's talking about healing, he or she is talking about healing. Is he trying to get something from us or to us? He's trying to get something to you. If the man or woman of God is talking about the Holy Spirit, is he trying to get something from you or to you? But if he's talking about money, is he trying to get something from you or to you? He's trying to get something to you. He's trying to get something to you. It wouldn't make sense that God would have a plan for our spirit and for our eternity, a plan for our health, healing for our body. But then when it comes to our finances, God says, well, you're on your own. Just get a job at Blockbuster or Montgomery Ward or... Those are all places that have gone out of business. See, God cares about your finances, and he wants you to have more than enough. Because God can't do a quick work in your life if there's slow money. Have we started yet? Are you ready? All right, let me show you the connection between your heart and your finances. We see this, that God sees these two things very connected. Let's look at John the Baptist. John the Baptist comes on the scene. Here he is, he's preparing the way for the Lord, right? He is launching the new move of God that's happening in the earth. For 400 years, there's been silence, And now here we have John the Baptist, anointed by God, who's coming out preaching repentance. He says, repent, the kingdom of God is at hand, and he's baptizing people, right? Right? You guys were just loud a second ago. Come on. Now, after he baptized them, he would say this. He would say, go bear fruit in accordance with repentance. And they asked him the question, what does that fruit look like? What does it look like to bear fruit in accordance with repentance? Now, this would have been a great time for John the Baptist to say, do an Esther fast or do a Daniel fast. There's nothing wrong with the Esther fast or a Daniel fast, but he didn't say to do that. This would have been a great time for him to say, do a 24-hour prayer chain with your neighbors. That's great, but he didn't say to do that. Interestingly enough, this is what he said. He said, and this is in Luke 3, he says, if you have two coats and you see someone without one, give them one. He said, if you have food and you see someone without some, give them some food. He says, be content with your wages. Don't steal from people. Everything he said had to do with their possessions and their stuff. So think about this. True transformation and repentance was so linked to the way that we handle our stuff that John the Baptist couldn't talk about the new thing God was doing in the earth without addressing our relationship to our possessions. He said, you guys have to be free of it. You can have these things, but don't let these things have you. Now, let's go a little bit further. Remember in Luke 19, Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus is short, but he's rich. He looks a little taller when you hear he's rich. So here he is. He's short. He's rich. He's a tax collector. He's nobody's favorite person. But Jesus comes and says, I want to have a meal with you. I want to come to your house today. Zacchaeus comes out of this meeting with Jesus and makes this declaration. He says, I'm going to give away half of my wealth to the poor. And if I've cheated anyone, I'm going to return it to them four times over. Now, Jesus, this would have been a great time for him to say, like, wow, what a great guy. Let's all put Zacchaeus on our shoulders and dance around the city. But Jesus says something even more profound. He says this. He says, today, salvation has come to this house. Zacchaeus has shown himself to be a true son of Abraham. I don't think you're getting this. Jesus judged the reality of Zacchaeus' salvation on his willingness and eagerness to part with his stuff for the glory of God and the good of others. There is a direct link between the way we handle our property and the way that we handle our relationship with God. They're completely linked up. Are you seeing this? Now, let's take it a little bit further, and I got to move fast. But let's look at this. Actually, the Bible says that your money, it doesn't just tell on you. Your money is a witness of either righteousness or wickedness. Take a look at this. Let's look at James chapter 5, verse 1 through 3, and I'll read it with you. James chapter 5. Let's start with verse 1. It says, come now, ye rich, weep and howl for your miseries that are coming upon you. Does it sound good? Next, okay. Your riches are corrupted and your garments are moth-eaten. Hold on now. How many of you have ever had moth-eaten clothes? Okay, we've had it. Moth-eaten clothes will never happen with the clothes that you're wearing. They're not going to eat it right off your back. So what they're talking about is that these guys have had stored up wealth, stored up garments that have been stagnant, and he's saying that this is a problem. Keep going, please. Your gold and your silver are corroded, and their corrosion will be a witness against you, and they will eat your flesh like fire, for you have heaped up treasure in the last days. Now, here's the thing. The wicked have heaped up treasure so that they can hand it over to the righteous. Because the wealth of the wicked is stored up for the righteous. So here we see that if we are hoarding up our stuff, this is a witness of wickedness. This is not the fruit of righteousness. Are you still here? Now let's look at another scripture. Let's look at the other side of this. Let's look at Hebrews chapter 11, verse 4. Are you learning? By faith, Abel offered to God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, through which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts, and through it, he being dead still speaks. His offering, Abel's offering, given in faith, pointed to, it was a witness of his righteousness, of his right standing with God. And I love what this says. It says that even though he's dead, that offering still speaks. See, there's a way that you can have a voice in the earth long after you're gone. If the Lord tarries and you go from this life into the unseen realm, you can still have a way of having your offering speak even after you're gone. See, like, think about the chairs that you're sitting in. A lot of you were here a couple years ago whenever we had the big campaign to put in new chairs. That offering that we put in is here. Now, after we go on to glory, these chairs will still be here speaking of the righteous gift that you gave. Is this making sense? That long after you're gone, your offering will still be in the earth, making a declaration. Something about offerings, they always are standing before the Lord. In Acts chapter 10, right, Cornelius, it says, your prayers and your offering has come up before me as a memorial. It's ever before the Lord. All right, I got to move further. Have you learned anything yet? So there is a direct connection between the way we handle our stuff and the way of our relationship with the Lord. And here's the next part I want to move to. Everything that we have, including prosperity, any miracles we have access to, is not because of anything we've done, it's because of what Christ has done on the cross. Amen? So on the cross, the Word of God says that Christ, who knew no sin, became sin so that you and I could become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Amen? So we can walk in righteousness because on the cross, he was made sin. He was that sin offering for us. Now, here we have salvation that's made available to us, but in order for us to move into the fullness that God would make available to us, we have to yield to the Holy Spirit. We have to yield to the Word of God. There's a part that we have to play in this to see the fullness of it come to pass. Making sense? On the cross, it also says that by the stripes that were placed on his back, that we could walk in health and healing. So there again, we see any access we have to miracles for healing happened right there at the cross. But we have a role to play in this as well. We can't just decide, you know what, I'm only going to eat KFC for breakfast, lunch, and dinner for the next 30 years, and I'm going to walk in absolute health and healing. I don't think so. We have a part to play in this, right? And did you know that on the cross, Christ also took our poverty upon him? Take a look at 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9. It says, for you know, which most people don't know, but you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might be rich. Are you seeing this? So the power of poverty and insufficiency was crushed at the cross. Okay, I gotta just take it a little bit further. I only have you for one chapel, so I really have to put this all into you, okay? Jesus did not walk around poor. This is important because a lot of people have a disconnect. They say, well, we're told that we're going to have life more abundantly. We're told that we're going to have prosperity. But then the one that we're following was walking around poor. Absolutely not. Christ walked around rich. He had a treasurer. Most homeless people don't have a treasurer. Would you agree? And here's the picture that just about this. On the cross, Christ became sin for us, right? It was on the cross that he became sin. He didn't walk around in sin his whole life. So they always said, I'm taking all the sins of the world on me. No, it was only on the cross. Sickness and disease. Christ didn't walk around with a stuffy nose and a headache and limping around everywhere. Say, well, I'm carrying all the sickness and disease of the world. No, it was on the cross, right? Also, in the same way, Christ did not walk around poor in the earth. It was on the cross that he was crowned the king of poverty. Ooh, this is good. So it's by his stripes, by the stripes that were placed upon him, we walk in health and healing. So where do we see the symbol for poverty? Where did he become the king of poverty? It happened, I'm glad you asked. It happened when they crowned him with that crown of thorns. Because as long as Adam and Eve were in the garden, there were no thorns in the earth. When they lived in opulence and had everything they needed, there were no thorns. It was only after they sinned that all of a sudden the ground is cursed. They said, it's going to be hard for you to work, and thorns came up. So Christ was crowned the king of poverty so that you and I could walk in more than enough. So that you and I could walk in prosperity. Don't be afraid of these words, because here's the thing. A lot of us are praying just to have enough. But enough is not enough for a child of God. We're supposed to have enough to feed the hungry, to clothe the naked, to provide for our family, to have something prepared for those that have nothing prepared for them. We're supposed to have an inheritance for our children and our children's children. That takes money. Are you still here? So God desires that we would have finances, but here's the thing. God won't get anything to you that he can't get through you. God won't give anything to you that he can't get through you. I mean, this is everything. His love, his forgiveness, all of this, he gives it to you with an expectation that it will go through you. He says, I've given you mercy that you would show mercy. And then he says this, and it's not my favorite verse, but he says it. He says, if you don't forgive others, he says, you think I'm going to forgive you? Hey, that's tough. But God won't get anything to you that he cannot get through you. So when it comes to finances, we've got to get a new perspective of not just, Lord, I want to have this much money, but no, it's, Lord, I want to be able to give this much money. I'm telling you, I've sat in a room, and I've seen it twice, where people have given $1 million into ministry. Two different occasions. Someone just said, here's $1 million seed. Wasn't to me, not yet. But you know what? When it happened, I thought, man, if this guy can do it, then I can do it too. But I wasn't even thinking like that. But we need to start expanding our view of what God can do. Because nothing is impossible for our God. All right, I got to move further. Let's go quickly through seed time and harvest from Genesis all the way into the New Testament. Are you ready? We're going to go fast. First time we see seed time and harvest in Scripture is Genesis 8:22. Noah gets out of the ark. He presents a sacrifice to God. This is after the flood. And God, in response to this offering, says, as long as the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer, winter, day and night, shall not cease. Are we still on the earth? So this principle is still activated. Now, of these four things, three of them we don't have anything to do with. We can't decide that we're going to have another 4 or 5 hours a night and then we'll start the day. We can't decide that we're going to have a white Christmas in the Bahamas. The only part of this that we have an active role in is seed time and harvest. So what is God doing? Is he giving us gardening instructions? It is in Genesis, right? No, see, he's not just giving us gardening instructions, because all truth is parallel. Are you still here? So he gives us this truth that as long as the earth remains, seed time and harvest will not cease. And then we see Jesus pick this up, and he takes this natural cycle and he gives it a supernatural application. He does this in Mark 4, Luke 8, Matthew 13. It's the parable of the sower. And Jesus says this in Mark 4. He says to the disciples, if you don't understand this parable, how will you understand any of them? Meaning this is a foundational parable, foundational teaching for understanding the kingdom. He says the kingdom of heaven is like a man sowing seed. Some falls in good ground, some falls in bad ground. If it falls in good ground, it's going to come back 30, 60, and 100 fold. Then he says the sower sows the word. The sower sows the word. See, thank you, Jesus. This is good. We need to have our faith and our expectation line up with the word, because it's the word of God that has seed time and harvest power. It's not just your words. It's his word in your mouth. In Isaiah 51, it says, I have put my words in your mouth that you might plant the heavens. That you might plant the heavens. See, there's a difference. I'm coming all the way down. There's a difference between just believing something and believing what the word of God says. Now, I'll tell you one that used to really confuse me was the lady who had the issue of blood. So here she is. She says within herself, if I can just touch the hem of his garment, I'll be healed. And she just kept saying it, and she kept saying it. And then she pushed through the crowd. She touched the hem of his garment, and she's healed. Jesus turns around and says, who touched me? Oh, what do you mean? She says, it's me. He says, your faith has made you whole. Now, I always struggle with this because I thought, did she just make that up? Like, I'm just going to, you know what, I just decide, as long as I wear green shoes, if I wear green shoes for 1 year, I'm going to be a millionaire. No, you can't just make up something and just decide that that's what it's going to be. This actually, what she did was found in Scripture. This lady knew the word. Take a look at this. Malachi chapter 4, verse 2. Hey! Malachi chapter 4, verse 2. But to you who fear my name, the Son of Righteousness shall arise with healing in his wings. That word wings is the hem of the garment. This lady knew the Bible. She didn't just have an idea. That's hocus pocus. She knew what the Bible said. And she knew, here's the Son of Righteousness. And if I can touch the hem of his garment, there's healing in it. And she received it. Are you seeing this? All right, watch this. In Luke 7, there's a centurion who has a sick servant. They come to Jesus and they say, this man has a sick servant. Can you go and pray for him? So then he's getting ready to go. And the man says, you don't even have to go. You can just say the word and he'll be healed. And Jesus is like, I haven't seen this much faith in all of Israel. And in that same hour, the Bible says that that man was healed. Now, what was he doing? Was he just calling his shots? No, what he was doing was quoting Scripture once again. Psalm 107, verse 20 says he sent his word and healed them. So he knew, here's Jesus. He can just send his word and it will heal them. See, the word of God is powerful. And when the word of God gets in your mouth, that's when power will be released. Hey! The word of God was spoken before it was written, and it was written that it might be spoken. Are we still here? Are you still here? I mean, of all the attributes and characteristics of God, of everything that he does, one thing is for certain. God speaks. That's what he does. He speaks. In fact, you go look in the garden, it says he's a voice. It says the voice of God was walking with Adam in the cool of the day. The voice. So we have a voice. Then we have the Spirit of God, which is called the breath of God. And then we have Jesus, that's the word of God. So we have words, breath. Are you seeing this? Hallelujah. Now watch this. There's something powerful that happens when you put the seed of the offering with the seed of the word. It really just amps everything up. Watch this. Look at, let's go back to Luke chapter 7. Let's go to Luke 7 and we'll look at, I think it's verse 2. We'll start there. Now a centurion who had a servant who was sick and at the point of death, who was highly valued by him. When the centurion heard about Jesus, he sent to him elders of the Jews asking him to come and heal his servant. Now this is a centurion. It's a Roman. He's a Gentile. Don't think Jesus didn't notice. Remember the Syrophoenician woman? He notices this. Well, let's see what happens. Asking him to come and heal a servant. And when they came to Jesus, they pleaded with him earnestly saying, he is worthy to have you do this for him, for he loves our nation. He is the one who's built us our synagogue. See, as long as the earth remains seed time and harvest, will not cease. And if you give, it will be given back to you. Here is a man who is outside of the covenant of God. He's a Gentile. But he recognizes the God of covenant, the God of relationship. And he says, I don't just want to go worship your God. I'm going to get my finances involved. I'm going to build you a synagogue. He got involved with the building program. You've never seen that. See, he had seed in the ground, so he had harvest on the way. So then when he comes and says, Lord, would you do this? And he already has seed in the ground. See, not every miracle is a harvest. Okay? Sometimes you might just pray, God, you don't have any seed in the ground, but God, I need this to happen, and God will do it. But every harvest is a miracle. Okay? Now watch this. God has given us seed time and harvest and tithing. It's a boat. It's a boat that we can get in to go from where we are to where God wants us to be. But a lot of people don't want to get in the boat. They don't want to get in the boat of seed time and harvest and tithing. Instead, you know what they want to do? They want to walk on water. They want to have miracle money, right? Here's the thing. Jesus only walked on water once. The rest of the time he got in the boat. God has given us this boat to bring increase into our lives. I said this last night. I'll say it again. Your job is not for your living. Your job is for your giving. Yes, sir. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 28 says, let him that stole steal no more. Let him work with his hands, do what is good, that he might have something to give. There is no job Jireh. There's only Jehovah Jireh. My job shall supply all my needs according to his written. No, it's my God, not my job. We have to have a perspective change. We have to have a shift. Are you still here? Are you learning anything? Now, what I'm saying, you might say, Jason, that's kind of a reach that we would see words being a seed and finance being a seed. But Jesus makes it clear in the Word of God. We see in 2 Corinthians 9, right in the context of an offering, God gives seed time and harvest power to what is sown into the offering. Hey, everyone, we're not going to have an offering letter, okay? I'm giving you this to help you, to equip you. Are you okay? Now, let me show you a couple of other things. So here God has given seed time and harvest power to the offering. Now, let's take this thing a little bit further. Because there's more to our relationship with God, and there's more to the offering than just having a financial increase. Let me say it again. There's more to the offering than just having a financial increase. In fact, I would take it as far as to say your entire relationship with the Lord rises and falls upon what happens at offering time. Oof. Jason, how can you say that? Well, let's look at something. If you know the Word of God, God knows the Word of God, the enemy knows the Word of God too. Now, Luke 12:34 says, where your treasure is, that's where your heart will be. So the enemy knows if I can keep them from putting their treasure into the kingdom, I can limit their level of intimacy with God. Are you seeing this? The enemy's playing for keeps. The offering time is a moment where we have an opportunity to draw our hearts nearer, closer to God. And the enemy looks at it and he says, if I can keep these people in debt, if I can keep them going from financial crisis to financial crisis, I can keep their treasure out of the kingdom. I can limit their level of intimacy with God. Don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying the more you give, the closer you are to God. That's not what I said. Are you still here? Okay. Now look at this. Oh man, I love it. I love the Word of God. Look at Luke chapter 16, verse 11 in the New Living Translation. Thank you, Jesus, for your word. This one has got legs. Are you ready? Luke 16, 11. If you are untrustworthy about worldly wealth, who will trust you with the true riches of heaven? If you are untrustworthy with pieces of paper with dead presidents on them, who will trust you with the true riches of heaven? Now, here's the thing. A lot of us are praying, God, we want to see our spiritual giftings develop. But I feel like there's a ceiling. Well, hold on. What are you doing? Are you stewarding your finances? Because the Bible says we're supposed to be stewards of the mysteries of God. And 1 Peter 4:10 says we are to be stewards of the manifold grace of God. We're supposed to be stewarding that. But a lot of us get caught up about money. And not you. No one here, right? But the people that you will be ministering to, this might be something that will come up that you'll need to address. Okay? Are you all right? So it's important that you can communicate this to your people. That everything rises and falls on this, on what happens at offering time. See, the enemy knows if every time there's an offering that you fumble the play, or that you go up and go to the bathroom, or you're getting a phone call, hey, it says telemarketer, but it might not be. I'm going to take it. You know, sorry, I'll be right back. During the offering, right? If the enemy knows this person can't handle their finances, the enemy knows you will never handle the true riches, he doesn't have to worry about you. And then we walk around saying, oh, the enemy's messing with me. I just can't get my breakthrough. La, da, 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 da. Enemy's not messing with you. Are you seeing this? Oh, okay. I've only got a little bit of time left. I'm not sure what direction to go. All right, let me show you one more thing, and I'm going to give you a demonstration. We take this scripture a little bit further. About the word and the seed of the word and these two things coming together. About the seed of the offering and the seed of the word coming together. This comes together in Philippians chapter 4, verse 17. Y'all, this is, you're going to love it. You okay? You can hear my text that's coming out, y'all. All right, it says, not that I, oh, now watch this. Paul is talking to the Philippians about an offering. And he says up a few verses earlier, he says, no other church communicated with me as far as giving and receiving except you only. Which means if your cousin goes to church and they say, our church doesn't talk about giving and receiving like that. Well, Paul said no other church communicated with him concerning giving or receiving except the Philippian church. So not everyone's going to be able to experience this grace. Are you okay? You can experience it, all right? Watch this. Here in the context of this offering, he says, not that I seek the gift, but I seek the fruit that abounds to your account. Now, how many of you heard the scripture? And a lot of the way that this is preached is that we have a heavenly account and we have an earthly account. And that whenever we give, it goes into our heavenly account. And that's true, because Jesus says that we shouldn't store up treasure on earth, but we should put treasure up in heaven, right? But that's not what this scripture is about. He's talking to them about an offering. He says, it's not that I desire your offering, but I desire the fruit that would abound to your account. And that word account is the Greek word logos. He says, it's not that I desire your gift, your offering, but I desire the fruit that would abound to your words. Yikes. There is another dimension of being able to speak a thing and see it come to pass whenever you have got seed in the ground and harvest on the way. Are you okay? All right. Here I have Let me get that. Let me get this. Now, James Payne, Bishop James Payne, he's also part of City Harvest Network. We'll just put it right here. He showed me this one day, and it changed my life, and I hope it changes yours, too. Are you ready? All right, after being around Bishop James Payne, I've started collecting seeds, right? So here we go. So here I have some. So what do I have here? And call it out what it is. Watermelon. Some say corn, some say corn seed. Everyone's wrong. This is a picture of corn. See, and this is the problem that a lot of believers have, is that we have a picture of prosperity, or we have a picture of our miracle, but we never experience the product. See, there's a difference. This is corn. Hey! So this is the picture of corn. So how do we get from the picture to the product? Through sowing seed. But a lot of us, we come to church, we read in the Word of God about the miracles, about the prosperity, about the corn. We take the picture home, then we try to eat the picture, and then we're not sustained. And then we have a form of corn, but we're lacking the power thereof. Right? So it's not enough for us just to hear and be hearers of the word. We've got to be doers of the word also. So how do we get from the picture to the product? We got to sow seed. Let's get one out. This one seed, it's a little guy. When it's sown, it will produce a plant that has two of these on it. Those two things will have set approximately 700 seeds on them. So that's one seed that equals 1,500 seeds. If you sow all 1,500 of those again, it's 2.2 million. Here's the point I'm trying to make. Every seed has the power, it has the potential to grow. But if we come to offering time and we say, well, they're trying to get something from me, we are missing out on what God is trying to get to us. God never asks for a seed without having a picture of the harvest in mind. Are you seeing this? God's not trying to get something from you. He's trying to get something to you. Oh, okay. So what do we do here? If we're going to sow, we need some soil, right? Right? We got some soil. Can we see over there? So here we have the seed. Are you ready to sow it? Here we go. You ready? Right there. How many of you think that we're going to get a harvest? See, just bringing your finances close to the kingdom is not going to produce a harvest. Some of us are struggling because we're coming and going, but we're not sowing. Are you seeing this? And then we get, oh, wait a minute. I was raised in church, so I know what to do. We got to speak to it. Right? You ready? Let's do it. Grow! Grow! Oh, I know. Seeing is believing, right? We need to get the vision board. We'll put this one right here. And we'll put the picture so he knows. How many of you think we're going to get a harvest now? No, see, it's ridiculous, right? But this is the picture that God paints for us when it comes to offerings. He says it's like sowing a seed, that your offering will come back to you. He says if you give, Luke 6:38, it will be given back to you. Oh, this is good. You ready for this? Give and it will be given back to you. What will be given back to you? Whatever you gave, the it. Catch this. No seed ever leaves your life. It leaves your hands, but it comes back in another dimension. Do you see it? No seed ever leaves your life. Are you catching this? We have a God who has a supernatural supply that will not run dry. Oh, I've got to slow down. I've got to stop. But I got to say this too. Do you remember whenever Elijah says it's that there's going to be a drought, and then he goes out into a mountain area, and it says that the Lord brought ravens that had bread that they were, or meat that they're feeding him, right? And then there was a brook. So he has the natural, he has this brook that he's drinking from, and then he has the supernatural, which these ravens were bringing him food. Now you go back and read that, it says that the brook dried up, but it never said the ravens stopped. The supernatural supply never stopped. The natural might dry up. But if the natural is not your source, if the supernatural is your source, there's always going to be more than enough. And whenever he left the ravens, he went to a town and he didn't ask for some food first. He asked for some water because that's what had dried up. So he asked for some water. Then he asks for some cake. And this is beautiful. He says, can I have some cake? Oh, and she says, I don't have any cake. She says, all I have is a little bit of flour and a little bit of oil. Flour and oil are what make cake. See how technical people get at offering time? God will say, I want you to give this amount. No, God, I don't have that. Come on. You know I don't carry that kind of cash. Lord, you know I'm on a fixed income. I only got this much this week, this much this week. But God knows if you put these things together that you would have enough. Right? Now, this woman, she had big plans. She was down to her last meal, right? And her big plans were to eat this and die. And the same thing is true for the people that you'll be ministering to. That they come to church and they have plans for their cake. They have plans for their bread. And then they hear it's offering time. And then they're in their thinking, they go, well, there goes the vacation. There goes the new tires. There goes the new house. But that's not what Elijah said. Elijah said this to her. He said, bring me some cake first and then go do as you've said. He said, you can still have your big plans. If you bring it to me first, there'll be more than enough. And the Bible says that the oil didn't run dry, the flour didn't run dry, as long as that drought was happening. Now, watch this. This is, I'm talking to someone who's going to be a pastor. Are there any pastors in here? Are you going to be a pastor? Hallelujah. Now, watch this. People will try and say, Jason, I feel bad at offering time whenever I'm presenting an offering opportunity because I know the situation of my people and they're down to so little and I feel like, how could I stand here and ask them for something? Now, this is the wrong perspective altogether. Because if Elijah had had that attitude about the widow of Zarephath, oh, she doesn't have anything, this is her last meal. If he would have had that attitude, she would have died within a week. But Elijah knew the word of God, and the word of God says that if you give, it will be given back to you. And as long as the earth remains, seed time and harvest will not cease. So it's not that they don't have anything, how can they give? It's, Lord, they don't have anything, how can they not give? They've got to get seed in the ground. They've got to get harvest on the way. Are you catching this? Well, I'm running out of time. I don't know what to do right now. Let me look at my notes. Are you okay? Have you learned anything? Thank you, Jesus. This is too good. I'll give you one more and then we're going to close, okay? One more of these hidden harvests. So we see this hidden harvest with the widow of Zarephath. She gave, she got back. The moral of the story is often told, well, God looks out for widows and orphans. That's true, he does. However, Jesus said in Luke 4 that there was only one widow in Zarephath that was sustained throughout the whole drought. This one was the one who activated seed time and harvest. We also saw in Luke 7 that the centurion had seed in the ground. He was positioned to receive. Now, here's the thing about Jesus. Jesus is a seed. That when Jesus came to the earth, he came in seed form. See, God plays by his own rules. So if God is going to do a move in the earth, he knows I have to do this in accordance with seed time and harvest. So whereas we always look at John 3:16 and we say, that for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. Whoever believes in him would not perish and have everlasting life. And we take that to mean that there's a home in heaven one day. And that's true, but there's more to it than that. Because God wanted a family. He wanted many sons and daughters. So he sowed his son, Jesus. Jesus was a seed. Jesus is a seed. Are you catching this? Jesus knew that he was a seed. The Bible says he was crucified and buried in a garden. And then whenever he's resurrected, Mary comes over, sees him, and says, hey, I thought you were a gardener. What's all this talk about the garden? See, they're saying this because he's trying to get you to realize that he's a seed, that he's the first fruits of new creation. Thank you, Jesus. All right, I'm going to stretch you a little bit, but stay with me. You okay? Is it okay? Okay. Now, Jesus knew that he was a seed. There's a moment in John 12 where they come up to him, the Greeks, Philip comes up, Andrew comes up, and they say, we have some Greeks that want to see you. They just want to put eyes on you. And Jesus says, unless a corn of wheat falls on the ground and dies, it abideth alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. And they're thinking, no, Jesus, I don't think you understood the question. There's some people here that just want to see you. He says, no, unless a corn of wheat fall on the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. See, what Jesus was conveying was before the cross, you couldn't see Jesus. All you could see was the Father. He says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. The things I do is what the Father does. The things I say is what the Father tells me to say. Before the cross, you couldn't see Jesus. But after he was crucified, after he was resurrected, and after his spirit came upon the body of Christ, now, if someone wants to see Jesus, they can come right here to Valor Christian College. Are you still here? They can look at you and see Jesus. Are you catching this? Because Jesus was a seed. All right. Have you learned anything? Here's what I want to do. As I said before, God won't give anything to you that he can't get through you. And there is an anointing that has rested on my grandfather, and it rests on me as well. And I know God wouldn't give that to me just for me. So what I would like to do is I'd like to pray for anyone who would like to receive this anointing, to have revelation about biblical economics, that would receive this anointing to have multiplication in their life. Is that okay? And for those of you joining online at our cohorts, this is for you too. There's nothing that God will give to you that he doesn't want to get through you. And this includes anointings, because no anointing leaves the earth. No anointing leaves the earth. Whenever Elijah went to heaven, he dropped his anointing down for Elisha. Elisha never let go of his anointing. Elisha went to the grave with his anointing still in his hands. And years later, whenever they dropped a dead body on top of his bones, it came alive, because no anointing leaves the earth. So I'd like to have an opportunity to pray for you. And this is a powerful moment. Let's not forget about what has happened earlier in the service. There was a breakthrough that happened. Right? It was a setup for this message. Because really, seed time and harvest is an expression of worship. It's just the next level of worship with God. He says, God, I've given you my heart. I've given you my health. I've given you my body, my future. Lord, I'm also trusting you with my finances. And this is going to be something that will, when you put it to work, it will bear fruit in your life perpetually. Now, I'm not just telling you something that I've read in one of my grandfather's books. I'm telling you something that I've seen and experienced. That there's been times where Jessica and I were looking at, well, what are we going to do for finances here? But we had seed in the ground. So Jessica and I, we were praying together in the morning, and Jessica said, I want to have a harvest today. I'm calling in the harvest today. And I was like, okay, let's believe for that. Then she said, by what time? And I was like, Jessica, I don't, what time do you think we should have the harvest by? She said, by 3:00, I want to have the harvest. I was like, you're not even giving God all day. We had seed in the ground, and at 2:45, we get a phone call. Someone sent us $5,000. It's, when you've got seed in the ground, God can bring more into your life. And as God trusts you, as you steward your finances, God can begin to move. I got so much. God can begin to move in you in a more dramatic way. How many of you were here last night? Awesome. I want to just piggyback on one thing I said about the difference from being led by God and being in the will of God. Do you recall? When it comes to us handling the finances of the Lord, there's an expectation that God has for us. Remember in the parable of the talents, Matthew 25, one guy gets 5 talents, one guy gets 2, and one guy gets 1. the master does not tell them to go multiply it. So here he is, he gives them this, and then he has an expectation that they would go do something with it. Now, two of them were thinking like stewards. Two of them then said, we have an opportunity to double this, to multiply this. One of them didn't have a steward mentality. He had the servant kind of mentality. He said, well, you didn't tell me to do anything with it, so I buried it in the ground. Here's what's yours. I'm giving it back. He missed his moment because he played the game of, I'm going to wait for God to tell me exactly what to give. Man, if God has put anything in your hand, there is an expectation for you to do something with it. Let the Lord lead you in this. But also recognize that you have an opportunity every single Sunday, every single day, really, with being online, you have an opportunity to take advantage of your role as a steward and see multiplication come into your life. Amen? We're not just being led, we're in the will of God. We're not just servants, we're stewards. We're not just stewards, he calls us sons, he calls us heirs, he calls us brothers, he calls us friend. Would y'all stand with me? Hallelujah. Let's go ahead and I just want to worship for a little bit. And then we're going to pray.
We ask all things exceedingly abundant above all that. We ask all things exceedingly abundantly above all that. We ask for exceedingly, abundantly, above all that. We ask all things he's going to do, abundantly, above all that. We ask all things he's going to do, exceedingly, abundantly, above all that.
For those of you that are cohorts or joining online, there are some of us who have been confused about this revelation. Now that you have this information, there's going to be new revelation that comes loose in your life. And I'm speaking to you, I'm speaking to everyone here, that you will see the goodness of God in the land of the living. You will see the enemy cut down like grass. You will see God show up and show out in your life like never before. Your finances is just another dimension of who you are. And once God can check this box and say, look, they have this now, now he can trust you with the next level of things, with the mysteries of God. There are spiritual giftings that are being loosed even today as we have a new understanding about this. All around the room, gifts of prophecy are being released, words of knowledge being released, spirit of wisdom, spirit of understanding. Even you joining online, there are those of you that are weak, and we're speaking right now that the spirit of might would come upon you in Jesus' name. That those of you that have been struggling with addiction, with different things, it's not that it's going to happen. Yes. It's happening right now. It's not that it's going to get better. It's better right now. Those of you that need a healing, it's happening right now. We speak against that spirit of infirmity. It must go. We speak health and healing into your people. We speak diabetes goes, that cancer must go in Jesus' name. Hypertension goes. Those of you with insomnia, it goes right now in Jesus' name. Those of you with headaches, it goes. Migraines, it goes in Jesus' name. Those of you that have had accidents long ago and you have residual pain in your body, it goes in Jesus' name. It cannot stay. It's not fixing to go. It's not about to go. Yes. It goes now in Jesus' name. Jesus. By his stripes, you were healed. That's in right. Jesus' That's name. Hey.
Hey. Abundantly, above all that. Hey. We ask all things God is going to do. Abundantly, above all that.
exceedingly.
There's people here, we have family and friends that are far from God. You've been interceding for them. You've been believing that they're going to come into that relationship with the Lord. The same relationship that you have, a personal relationship with the Lord. I want to encourage you to keep on interceding. I love this. See, interceding is two words, enter and seed. Hey, it's not just that we're standing in the gap for someone. It's that we're taking the seed of the word and we're planting the heavens into that situation. You can be planting the heavens on behalf of that loved one. You can be planting the heavens on any situation or circumstance. But it changes now in Jesus' name. We speak a dramatic change happens in their life in Jesus' name. Hey! There's an anointing that's here right now. If you would like a touch from God, please come down to the front. And I just want to pray over you, pray for you. Those of you that are joining online, you can at this moment just press into this. Please come. Please come. The Lord can touch you wherever you're at. All over the world, we have cohorts that are in the East Coast, the West Coast, and everywhere in between. And the Spirit of God knows no limitation. Amen. This is a changing day in your life. Depression goes in Jesus' name. Stomach pain goes in Jesus' name. Addiction goes in Jesus' name. The common struggles, that the sin that so easily gets us, it goes today in Jesus' name. I look around and I'm looking at the world leaders of tomorrow. You have to see yourself the way that God sees you. He doesn't see you as about to be something. He sees you as completed. Are you seeing this? He sees you as completed in Him. He already sees you as that king. He already sees you as that pastor, that man or woman of God. He already sees you having that mountain-moving faith. You've got to see yourself in that same way. You've got to see yourself in the fullness of all that God has made available to you. I'm going to go around and pray. And if I'm not to you yet, I want you to start interceding about your situation, interceding about what you want to see God do in your life, because it's not about to happen. It's happening today in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
Abundantly, above all that, God's gonna do it. Exceedingly, exceedingly,
Oh,
God. We're rich in shedding the love of God in a dark world. We're rich in you, Jesus. Oh, God, once we have you, we have everything we need. I am blessed because of the Lord God Almighty. Hey, hallelujah. Yeah, hallelujah. 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 Hey, give it to him. Hallelujah. Give it to him. Hallelujah. Worthy.
Online campus, this was such a dynamic and powerful word that was released through City Harvest Network overseer Jason Avanzini. It has opened our eyes to a Absolutely. New perspective about red seed and seed time and harvest and giving, and Absolutely. It has just taught us so much. I don't know about you all, but I have learned so much today, and it has given us so much wisdom and revelation. And what if we could tell you that God wanted to use you as a seed to plant you in fertile and good soil here at Valor Christian College, because he has a bigger picture in mind?
Absolutely. Don't waste any more time. If you feel yes. that God is calling you, that there's a call of God on your life, don't waste any more time.
Right.
Go to valorcollege.edu and get registered for this fall semester.
Yes.
Don't forget that financial aid and scholarships are available
right.
to the qualifying students. And listen, this is not just on Thursday mornings, yeah. but it's also on Sunday mornings
yes.
and Wednesday nights. And this Sunday, you don't want to miss it, because Dr. Rod Parsley is going into a service talking about the signs of the sky.
Yes.
This Sunday morning at 10
this
a.m.
Sunday.
Be sure to tune in at World Harvest Church. We will see you on Sunday morning. God bless.
See you.
Our nation is corroded by chaos, and a chilling truth has emerged. Ancient prophecies foretold it. Documented history proved it. The drought of moral disaster set in motion by idolatry. In his brand new book, New York Times best-selling author Rod Parsley uncovers the 10 insidious idols gripping our country and tearing apart the fabric of our families. As materialism blinds us, technology consumes us, and perversion enslaves us, these idols are orchestrating a symphony of destruction. But there is hope within reach, a lifeline in the storm, a chance to break free from this cultural stranglehold now, before it's too late. Are you ready to destroy the idols? Idolatry in America, the new book by Rod Parsley, available February 6th. For more information, visit idolatryinamerica.com.